third-party data brokers that oftentimes is inaccurate, or more commonly we're using registration where we learn, you know, somewhat limited information about our consumers. But that's really because that's all we had access to as marketers before the last couple of years. But now, thanks to the ubiquity of social networks, we have 2 billion consumers that has told us a lot about themselves through their social profiles, through Facebook or Twitter or LinkedIn or Google, or internationally, there's really 30 different social networks. On these profiles, they're telling us who they are, their name, their email, they're just some basic information, but they're going beyond that. They're telling us about their, where they work, where they went to school, if they're married. They're telling us about their birthday. And they're even going beyond that to share things about, like, their interests, their likes. They're telling things about their social graph and some other components as well. We call this a user's social identity. And social networks have made this information available to businesses via permission-based access that a user grants. And this becomes a cornerstone for really understanding who a consumer is, for really understanding who a user is. And so that's really what we're going to talk about today, is how do we access this information, manage it, and take advantage of that. So let's just move forward here. So we're really going to talk about 6 phases or 6 steps for an overall strategy to use social data to drive conversions. And I'm going to personally focus on the first 3 steps here, which is around accessing this data, managing it, and then initially segmenting this data. And then I'm going to turn it over to Sean, who will work through steps 4 through 6, which will really talk about how to leverage this data, take action on this data, and measure this data. Before I get into this, let me just first give you a little bit about the perspective of where I'm coming from, and uniquely being the CEO of Gigya, let me just tell you a little bit about the company. Gigya has been around since 2006. We work with over 700 clients today, and these are all the largest consumer-facing businesses on the web. So about 45% of ComScore 100 properties, the top 100 websites in the U.S. use Gigya's technology. So these are top retailers like Victoria's Secret and Nike and L'Oreal and L'Occitane and others, top, you know, travel sites like Orbis, top brands like Pepsi, and media companies like ABC and Fox and others. And to share a little bit more about how we work with these businesses, Gigya offers a connected consumer management suite. So this is a SaaS-based technology that helps marketers better understand their consumers through accessing rich consumer identity information, and then ultimately use this rich identity information to impact traditional marketing, as well as on-site engagement. And we do that through 3 different technologies: connect, collect, and convert. Connect is about accessing this rich data. Collect is about storing and managing this data. And then convert is about using this data to impact marketing. But that's enough about sort of our background. Let me get right into the content. So I mentioned we're going to start with, how do you access rich social data? And that's really the starting point for increased relevance through social. So to jump in and to reframe the discussion, again, we're trying to move from knowing very little about consumers, maybe through kind of traditional registration data. It's still important data, but moving beyond that to even gain richer access to even more data. And so the types of things you get from social data are profile data, gender, age, birth date, relationship, education. You get interest graph data, so what are their favorite movies and TV shows and books and many other pieces of content. Social graphs, so who are their friends and what are their friends like, and even behavior. So this is on-site behaviors, things like comments, reviews, shares, what pages do they go to, what do they buy, all these different components. That represents the social identity. But how, as a business, do you get access to this? This comes down to a technology called social login. So first of all, you can always log in and register the traditional way, which we're showing you Forbes, which is actually a Gigya client here, which is the right-hand side of the screen. But what I'm talking about is what you see on the left-hand side of the screen, which is logging in or registering using a social account through technology like Facebook Connect, Twitter Connect, Google+, et cetera. And what we're finding is this is really becoming a standard on the web. It's becoming a standard for a couple of reasons. One is it's much easier for users to sign in socially. So the average user has 28 different accounts and 8 different passwords. The forgotten password flow is the number one help desk question. We've all gone through the pain of having to go through that forgotten password flow. So what businesses find is when they implement social login, they get an increased signups. It's anywhere from 10 to 40%. So dramatically increased signups by streamlining that flow. And if you talk about mobile, this becomes an even bigger issue to have to create an account from scratch. But the second reason social login is becoming a standard is the data. So when someone logs in socially, they're giving you access to that rich profile information that we just talked about, that interest graph information, that social graph information. It's permission-based access. I'll show you in the next slide how that's done. And there's various things to consider when you implement social login. One is we recommend choice. So we do find Facebook in the U.S. is the most popular social provider, but we do find that consumers prefer choice because they have different identities. So they have their sort of, or personas, I should say. LinkedIn is their work persona, whereas Facebook may be their social persona. G+ may be a persona where they want to connect with their closest friends. So we're finding that choice is really important. And internationally, choice becomes important because the most popular social networks internationally aren't the same as those here in the U.S. But let's go through that flow. So a user's going to click Facebook here, and they're going to go through the authorization process. And it's really important here that this user is providing permission-based access to the brand, in this case Forbes, to access certain pieces of data. And Forbes can choose which pieces of data that they want to actually ask permission for. And a best practice is you only ask for permission for those pieces of data that you're really going to leverage and utilize here. But you can see it's just one click. So they're going to click OK. And then at this point, that data is then given to that brand, in this case Forbes. And this is a subset of what some of that data can be, just so you can get a sense. It does differ by social provider, but you can see extremely rich data set. One of the side notes, one of the things to consider is the data does come with different formats and different field names from provider to provider. So you need to think through or work with a vendor that can help you standardize this type of data across different providers. But I'm going to get more into that here just in a couple slides. Before I do that, it's important to note that social login, while of course the number one place to get users to log in is during that sign up and registration flow, you can have different locations that you ask that user to connect. For example, on-site interactions. So this could be in a review or a comment section of a site, for example, or joining a loyalty program. You can do this with different devices, so mobile, tablet. We're starting to see some interesting things with kiosk in-store interactions or during point of sale. So there's really different connections points. And then through email, you can have calls to actions in the actual emails that you send to get people to sign up and register. So there's just going to be different places that this can happen. Now let's move forward. We just talked about how do you access social data, and social login becomes a key and critical component to gain access to that data. But how do you actually store and manage this data? Because there are quite a bit of complexities that you need to consider that you may not have thought about previously. So let's talk about the nature of social data. Social data is a lot of data. You hear the term big data thrown around, but it really is. When you sign up the traditional way, you as a business are going to for sure probably get less than 10 pieces of data. It's a very structured data set that you get through registration. When you implement social login, you get 100 pieces of data, 200, sometimes 300 pieces of data. Some of it's structured and some of it's unstructured. So you need to start thinking about a database that can handle all of that data. Most existing businesses that we speak to prior to an engagement have relational databases. These are databases that are like an Excel spreadsheet. They work great for structured data, 5 or 6 or 7 pieces of data. But when you start to think about all of this data that you're going to get access to with social, you need to start thinking about some of the new types of databases. For example, schemaless databases that can essentially handle an unlimited amount of data from each and every consumer, both structured and unstructured. And if you want support of why that becomes necessary, what this chart shows you is actually the amount of data being created on the web. The blue bar is the data that's considered structured data. The green bar is the data that's considered unstructured or semi-structured data. And you can see five, six, seven times the amount of unstructured data compared to structured data being created. So marketers today that really want to consider how do you take advantage of all this rich social data need to be thinking about database structures, for example, schemaless database structures that can take advantage of this. So that's one component of social data you need to consider. The other component of social data is it's evergreen. It's always being updated. So people are maintaining their social profiles all the time. And it's a great advantage to social login is you can actually create a sync between a social profile account and a database that's actually storing this data in a permission-based way. So I'm just drawing an example here to really drive home this point. So you could take David Bridle, one of Gigya's clients, and perhaps Claire, this is Claire's Facebook profile, perhaps Claire registered for David Bridle with her Facebook credentials a year ago because she was a bridesmaid in a wedding. All of a sudden, you know, it's Claire's turn to get married, and she says on Facebook she's now engaged here to Timothy. That becomes a signal, a data trigger that can be actually stored and notified in a database, which then can be utilized in a customized email campaign. So now you can actually put Claire in a segment of those that are planning a wedding, right? And that becomes a really important data point. And there's lots of other signals you can talk about, but we call this technology social sync, but it's the key of keeping data always updated and looking for those data signals, if you will. Now moving forward, another complexity of social data is compliance. So each social network has their own terms of service that need to be adhered to when you store social data. So Facebook, for example, if you log in to a website using Facebook and you later deauthorize that permission as a user, you say, I don't want that website to access certain pieces of data anymore. That business has to delete certain pieces of data in their database. Again, it's a complexity, but the key is you need to actually programmatically do things to manage this in your database. And there are folks out there that can help you. This is something we help our clients with. We call it social compliance, but that's going to be a complexity you want to consider. And finally, another piece about data storage is you need to think about storing behaviors and on-site behaviors. So these are things like comments and reviews and purchases and shares. These are all critical data points you can tie to a user's identity. And these data points can serve as signals which can help you drive relevancy in the email and different marketing campaigns you're doing. So again, we go back to Forbes as a client. You may know because you track the behavior of a user that they viewed a certain section of the site like the cloud computing section. And that can help you customize that weekly digest that you're going to send that individual later that week to have content around cloud computing. And we call these signals around storing behavior data. Okay, so we talked about accessing this rich social data via social login. We talked about storing this data. Now let's get into the meat of how do you actually start to use this data. And I'm going to begin speaking about this through segmentation and then turn it over to Sean, who will drive this forward even further. So one of the things that you need to consider when you start taking advantage of this data is having a segmentation technology that can actually segment against these new types of data points you're going to store. So you're moving beyond just core demographic data, and you're starting to be able to see rich social data, things like interests and likes and activities. These are new check-ins. These are new types of data points. You're also talking about new types of behaviors that you may want to target against. So these are things like the comments and the shares and the views. You need to make sure that a segmenting technology can view this data and segment against this data. Those are the types of segments you're going to want to start to create, and Sean will speak more about that here in a little bit. And you're also going to want to make sure that wherever you're storing that data, you can easily push that into the third-party marketing tools that you're going to leverage the data within. And of course, Gigya has a partnership with StrongView, so that's going to be one of the critical components of where we'll take that data and push it into the StrongView system for further personalization and email sending. But we're going to get to that here in a minute. So just to summarize kind of the key takeaways from the first section of this webinar, the key first is to access the data using these new technologies like social login and doing so in a permission-based way. Second, it's collecting and managing this data in a database that's been designed to handle modern identity data and the complexities with that. And then finally, select a platform and a segmentation technology that can organize this data and display all the rich consumer identity data and segment against that rich data. So that ends the first section of the webinar, and I'm going to turn it over to Sean, who will talk about how to actually leverage and take advantage of this data.
Excellent. Thanks for that. And it's a really good setup. I think, you know, hopefully everyone's got a sense of how much richness of information is really in the social data and how much insight that richness can provide you into your, you know, end consumers and what their needs, wants, and desires are. And so, you know, from here on, I'd like to take, you know, a picture and show you how that insight, we can turn it into action, and how do we take that data and make better marketing with it. So starting with, as Patrick spoke about, you know, the ability to really export that information from the Gigya systems into other systems like our StrongViews and really start to leverage it for better marketing campaigns. So let's start with, you know, talking about, you know, segmentation and really adding that social data to the other profile information you might already have in our system or system that you're using to execute marketing. And so, you know, you'll see that, you know, today you might have very valuable sort of static profile data, but you may be lacking certain variables. And so, you know, I think there's great examples. We'll walk through some examples in the future of how, you know, you may know a lot about your customers, but you may still not know gender is one case. And so there's ways to take that as a valuable nugget of information into what you have today and really create the ability to open up new segmentation possibilities to drive further targeting of your end consumers. Now, on top of that, you can also start to, you know, add this type of static or, you know, maybe in the case of social, some of the dynamic information to other types of behavioral or interaction data. So, you know, how are people interacting with your email? How are people interacting with your SMS messaging? And use that in combination to start, again, to further define your segments, to further understand how your different consumers are bucketed into different areas and really, you know, ultimately get down to the finest grain targeting possible to really reach people with the most relevant messaging. And so that's the beauty of really adding this data into existing data you have today to really start to look new at how your customers fall into different groups and buckets. So what do you do with that? Great, we've got the data in the system. We have tools for segmentation on both sides of the equation. And really now, how do you bring that to life? How do you take those segments, take that deeper, richer understanding of the customer, and do better marketing with it? And that's where it comes into the execution side, really what we call the action of marketing. And so, you know, overall segmentation does drive relevancy, and there's many examples of this, and I think you can probably all think of those in your own businesses and worlds where, you know, if you had that incremental nugget of data, you could drive a better campaign. And so, you know, gender, I mentioned, is really one of the low-hanging fruits of this. If, you know, a lot of businesses in their registration process over the years have tried to collect gender, and I think with varying degrees of success. And so, you know, that's a nugget of information that may be very difficult to extract through its traditional registration process. But through a social connect, you know, consumers are more easily willing to give it up because they're getting something in return. They're getting that easy ability to log in and, you know, avoid the password problem and all that benefit that they get as an individual in exchange for giving up certain types of information. So, you know, here's a case where, you know, Johnny Cupcakes is a business that was really trying to reach their customers, and they have different, you know, appeals and approaches based on men versus women. And so that ability to understand who is a man, who is a woman, gave them a better targeting solution. And birthday campaigns, this is the where social data can actually introduce new types of campaigns and new triggers for you to engage with your consumers that you may not have access today. And I love this example. This is one I personally think is fantastic because, you know, who doesn't like getting these emails? I think we all do. Yeah. And they're, you know, talk about, you know, surprise and delight your consumer. A birthday email is a great way of doing that. And what we found over the, you know, past few years is that these are very, very high-performing campaigns. And the challenge with executing them has always been, well, I've never really been able to gather the birth date of my, you know, consumer. And so social data is another example where that's relatively, it lowers the bar for someone to give up that information. They're getting something in exchange. It's part of that profile that you can bring into your solution by adding that to the permissioning. And really then from there, you can really start to launch these very, you know, surprise and delight type of campaigns where, you know, you're sending something of great value that converts very well for you as a business and creates both, you know, brand affinity, and as well as a direct response in terms of real ROI and revenue. So I love a birthday campaign because who doesn't love to get a birthday surprise? I think, you know, the other interesting things, if you start to peel the onion of what types of data is in that social data stack, you know, looking at it has a potential for understanding the locality of your consumers. So this is sort of the geo-targeting, if you will, by using social data. So, you know, partly what you saw in Patrick's earlier thing is that, you can request they share where they currently reside. And that's a great indicator for what might be something which is relevant for them. So, you know, in this case, I Finish Line, who does a lot of college sportswear, used that type of information to really say, you know, we can target people for what is likely to be a resonant, an appealing pitch for them in terms of what sporting team is most closely located to them. And so you can think of many ways to apply that. You know, in retail, this is a great way to say, hey, you know, if I'm a retailer and I have physical locations as an example, I can use this type of information to notify people that might be interested in, you know, store activities, events, or openings that are happening local to them. And so, again, that's a piece of data that, you know, you think of traditionally might come from a mobile type of opportunity or some other maybe, you know, registration, if it will. But here's a way where it's very easy to get it, and you can start to do a little better targeting based on that type of data. And I think the biggest chunk of this, which is really interesting and where you can sort of take it from, you know, really into the advanced side of things here, is really if you look at social interactions overall, it's a huge possibility and potential to understand the interests and intents of your consumers. And so extracting those interests and intents allow you to really take targeting to a whole other level. And so, you know, in this example of, you know, art.com, you know, consumers are expressing their interests in their art preferences through Facebook or other social networks. And if you, as art.com, can really understand that, your ability to reach them with a relevant message becomes much, much greater. And so, again, at the end of the day, that relevancy is what matters, because that's where you're going from just blasting them with a marketing message to really delivering them a valuable piece of insight or information that they can really, you know, take and act upon. So that's sort of how we get into the action side, and then where do we take it from there? Well, really, you know, it's great that we execute these campaigns. I think we're all very excited about doing this type of targeting execution, but really at the end of the day, it comes down to measuring what works. And so I want to spend a minute or two on that and really talk about, you know, how you should really look at these campaigns and measure them and then test and optimize them over time. So, you know, first and foremost, you have to have a solution for doing this. So the standards of reporting to understand how people are engaging with these messages, you know, be them in email and mobile or other channels, how are people actually, you know, understanding and opening, responding, and eventually clicking through and converting against these messages. And so that's very important to understand as you launch a new campaign, as you know, maybe you're testing if your male-female segmentation strategy versus not. You really need to understand what's going on at the aggregate level. But you can't stop there, right? You have to really continue to dig to know what's really going on. And so you need the tools that allow you to drill into the details. And so, you know, having that data in the system, so, you know, having male, having female in the system, allows you to now further refine and parse the information to say, really, what's working? Is there, you know, based on gender, maybe there's another way of saying it, is it gender by age, by income, to say, well, what other segments might we discover in terms of what's performing very well, and then how can that discovery and insight to lead us to maybe go get more information to add to the system for better refinement, or maybe even just take the existing information and create new segments and new campaign types around what we've discovered. So it's really important to have those powerful tools that allow you to drill into the data to really understand at a really fine-grained level what's really happening and what's really working for your marketing campaigns. And then beyond that, you know, you really need to sort of set up the ability to test and optimize over time. You know, I'm a old school marketer. I've been doing this for a lot of years, and so, you know, I can regale you with always be testing, or a dozen other ways of summing up this thing that testing should be a part of what you do as a marketer day in, day out. And so having the right tools to do that effectively is important. And so you'll see, I think, you know, social data is a great means of opening up new possibilities for new types of tests. And if you have the systems, you know, like a StrongView that allow you to do that at scale in a multivariate testing environment, you can really not only learn a lot about what's working and what's not and how to improve things, but really improve things over the long haul and drive better results through increasing the relevancy for your consumer and understanding through the data what relevancy really means to your end consumer. So really, you know, put testing at the core of anything you're doing in marketing and using this new types of data to really enhance and improve the types of things you can test and optimize. So, you know, StrongView is really we see Gigya as a very valuable partner of ours and something as we build out what is the next generations of marketing, leveraging a lot of this types of new big data and ability to understand consumers at a different level. We're really excited about the possibility and potential of this. And if you look, you know, we work with a lot of major brands across retail, travel, you know, financial services and other verticals. And I think when we talk to our customers and we engage with these brands, we find, you know, numerous examples of people that are thinking about this and really wondering how to take their marketing to the next level. Everyone sees this big wave of big data, and they're still not quite sure what to do about it, how to act upon it. And so looking at the simple things and how you can really start the process of moving down that road to being a more sophisticated marketer is very important. Really, that combination of deep customer insight and that ability to really act on it in near real time is the important thing for being a successful marketer. So what are the takeaways from the sort of the part two, if you will? I think, you know, the theme here that you've heard throughout is really relevancy wins. So relevancy breeds frequency. It's no longer a world where we can just continue to push out volumes of messaging against our consumers. We really have to be smarter than that. We have to take our messaging and make it resonate and make it relevant to the end consumer. And that's only going to be done through better context. And so context is both from the interactions that they have with the emails you're sending to the social data and the footprint they're leaving behind on the social sites that you can learn about that end consumer and what their preferences and needs are. And so it's the combination of all that. It's looking across all the channels of touch points that you can possibly think of for your end consumers that's going to make your marketing more relevant. And at the end of the day, that's really what's going to end up driving better results. So think about that. Think about how you can now start to leverage these new tools, so including social sign-in across your website, across your email. As Patrick was mentioning earlier, there's numerous places you can use this as a means to, you know, engage and learn more about your end consumer. So leverage those abilities. Take that data. Use it for the finer grain segmentation, the increase of the personalization for your existing campaign. So you know, you have right now dozens, if not, you know, multiple dozens of campaigns running. And if you think about those, how could that extra bit of information, that gender field, that birthday field, how might they actually make those campaigns better? You can then do dynamic content to say, hey, you know, here's the offer that's more relevant for that segment based on what I can now understand from the social data. You know, leverage those new campaigns. I come back to the birthday campaign. It's one of the simplest examples that really drives outstanding results. And really, frankly, where most marketers today just are lacking that single bit of information to start. And so there's an easy way to get that single bit of information. It opens up a new campaign type that you probably aren't doing today. And you can think of dozens of others. There's other ways in which, you know, as Patrick mentioned, the engagement trigger. There's many of these little simple bits of information that people are leaving behind in their social engagements. As a marketer, you should think of how can I now trigger a new campaign and reach them with a very relevant information in the right time. And so starting to think about those things is really important and where we see a lot of positive traction with the people that are at the forefront of trying this stuff out. And lastly, it's really simple to start. I mean, this is something where you have great partners like Gigya, you have great solutions like StrongView, which enable you to really make it simple to really get going. It is, you know, the right tool makes the solution easy, and so adding that ability to socially connect, having the right system to pull in that data, put it together in place, and give you the right means to segment it and then execute upon it, that really, at the end of the day, makes it quite simple. So it's something you shouldn't be overwhelmed by, you know, thinking about the vastness of the social graph. Think about how you can just start down the road with the simple things and learning more about your end consumers and how through that learning you can create a more relevant message. So at the end of the day, you know, what have we seen in our customers and the folks we're talking to now? We've seen that people who are trying this are seeing great results, and we're seeing a lot of independent validation of that. So, you know, if you take you know, David Daniels of the Relevancy Group, you take Forrester. What the analysts are saying overall is that the combination of these things, that more data drives more relevancy, is really absolutely driving more revenue. And it's driving more revenue by higher performance, deeper engagement, and the better long-term lifetime value of those end consumers. So we're very bullish on this as a great way to really start thinking differently about how you reach consumers and engage with them. And so I think it's a good thing as you are out there thinking about your own marketing and your own campaigns, you know, how do you make them more relevant, and tapping into this new source of information is really critical to being successful. So with that, I think we do have a few minutes to open up to questions. I'll turn it back over to John, our moderator, to maybe kick that process off.
Thank you, Sean. We're now going to open the floor up to questions. If you'd like to ask a question, please type it in the Q&A box or click the question mark icon located on the floating toolbar in the lower right-hand side of your screen. It looks like we do have a few questions here. Let's see. Here's a good question. What types of privacy concerns should a marketer have when using social data in another channel?
Sure. I can take at least an initial stab at that. So this is Patrick speaking. We actually did a study to really understand what are some consumer concerns around social login. And what we found in that study is actually the majority of consumers had actually logged in socially. So it's becoming very, very prominent. But those that haven't, there were some concerns around transparency. They were concerned about what was happening with their data. Was it being sold? They were concerned, was their newsfeed being spammed? Were their friends within the social network channels being sent messages they didn't give permission to? And we actually took that study and we talked to some leading privacy organizations like the Future of Privacy Forum. And together, actually began an initiative to increase transparency. And so we launched what's called a social privacy certification seal. It's a consumer-facing seal that gives promises to a user that you're going to handle their data in a trusted way. And what we've seen is that when you actually implement something like that certification seal, which is a proxy for transparency, for saying what you're going to do with the data, you get increased signups that are pretty significant. We found it 18%. So the takeaway there is that I think it's important to be transparent in terms of how the data is being used, why it's being used, and when that happens, you're actually going to get a better user experience and more signups. So that's something we found is really important.
Great. Thank you, Patrick. Looks like we have a couple more here. Do all social networks pass an email address at authentication?
Yeah, this is Patrick again. I can touch on that. So the answer is the vast majority of social networks do provide email address. There is a small subset, a handful. Again, there's something like 30 different social providers internationally that do not provide that email address, although that trend is changing, by the way. We're seeing more and more openness over time. And for those that don't provide email address, you can still get the benefits of social login, but ask in a secondary, very simple form for that user to provide access to their email address. So we call it two-step registration, but it's a user experience that you'll see often on websites to ensure that email address is captured, which obviously is critical. But that's really the minority of the time because the vast majority of the popular social networks do provide email address.
Thanks again, Patrick. Here's another question. If personalization is key to marketing, what excuses are you hearing from marketers as to why they're not doing it?
That's a really good question, John. You got a chuckle from both of us over here. I think the excuses that marketers use today, and I wouldn't call them excuses so much as constraints to actually being successful. I think everybody does understand inherently this is the way it should be, that good marketing is really going to be driven by really understanding consumers at a deeper level and using that to drive more relevant messaging, more personalized. And so I think that's not a new, you know, theory. That's been really in place all along. And so it's less excuses, it's more constraints. And I think the constraints are some of the ones that are being removed right now. So it's really about access to the information primarily. So without that access to information, you really can't be successful with driving relevancy because you're just sort of shot in the dark against, you know, your customers. And so it is things like bringing in social data into your execution engine that really is going to make a lot of difference. And so thinking broadly about all of the possible consumer touch points that your consumers are choosing to interact with you, and they're flowing seamlessly across all of them to date. And so in each of those, you have to think about, how do I learn about my consumer through those interactions, and then use that learning to drive better marketing. So I think, you know, one of the most exciting things that's happened in the recent past is this enabling of the social data and extracting that information and learning, using it to learn about consumers and their needs. I think that's really got a lot of promise in terms of driving better marketing. And so it's again, it's not so much excuses, it's that the tools have been missing. And so now we're seeing those tools are becoming readily available, and great companies like Gigya are out there to help you extract that kind of knowledge and information and use it to do better marketing.
Great, thanks again, Sean. Here's another question. Are users opting to provide their social data via a resource like Facebook Connect, or are brand marketers finding that they're collecting social data from users who haven't socially logged in?
Yeah, so this is Patrick. What I'm seeing is that there's a real trend towards this permission-based access via official social authentication APIs like Facebook Connect or other social login APIs. And the reason is it's just much richer data that can be accessed. So, you know, I've heard one stat that 90% of Facebook profiles are actually private, which means sort of that public data you wouldn't even be able to get access to. So it becomes a pretty big differentiator. Social login also gives you, you make sure you tie it to the actual identity of the user. Now, you know, I think this can be augmented. There can be other sort of, if you will, public social data that can augment profiles that with users that don't log in socially. That is happening. But we see a trend moving towards more permission-based access to those kind of official social APIs because of the amounts of data and because it's a permission-based way to access that data. And I'll say finally, there's no cost to the business. I mean, that's a significant differentiator. Businesses are having to pay for those sources that aren't these kind of official authentication APIs. So there ends up being a pretty big benefit there as well.
Yeah, and I'll just add a little bit of that, John. I think the obviously as a company that has email as one of the cores to our business, you know, permission-based communication is something that we hold in high regard. And I think that, you know, the thing that I've seen overall with, you know, things like Facebook Connect and other sort of the permission-based side of the data extraction is really it comes down to a value exchange. You know, I know personally, I like engaging with brands using that tool because it delivers a value to me. And so it is that, you know, rather than having to sit there and fill out a form, I'm getting that ability. I don't have to remember the password. It works. It's seamless. And so for me, that's a great user experience. And so it's that combination of you're delivering a great user experience while gaining permission to learn more about them that I think creates a real win-win.
Thanks, Sean. It looks like we have a quick follow-up question to your comments. How and where do you add permission-based access?
Sure, I can touch on this. This is Patrick. So, you know, I think it's critical at the initial touch point of the consumer when you're asking for that data. So this would be, for example, obviously in the sign-up and registration process. That would be one location. But there's other touch points where you're asking users to connect now. It's not just through the sign-up and registration process. We alluded to this earlier, but this could be things like if you have a reviews functionality and you're asking a user to leave a review, that's a place where you're asking permission and you want to surface how you're going to leverage and use that data. We're actually seeing some really interesting trends like having people sign up for loyalty programs in a point of sale, like in store, and that's really a trend I think we'll see continue down the road. And of course, anywhere on a profile management page. And it's not going to just be the permissions to access the data, but as Sean pointed out, it's obviously permissions around the messaging in general, which StrongView obviously specializes in giving those tools and technologies to businesses to offer to their consumers and the user interfaces around those. So, yeah, absolutely.
Great. Oh, John, did you have another comment there? Or?
No, thank you. Thanks, John.
Okay, great. So here's a great question. Aside from the registration, since we're kind of speaking to that, could you provide some insight into other ways to collect social data?
Yeah, I think it actually touches on the last question really, really well. So It's really any touch point with the consumer. So you'd think about an iOS or an Android app. I mean, that's going to be a great location. I mentioned like the different sections of the site, whether it's some businesses are having gamification programs, which are incentives and behavior driving loyalty programs, kiosks, et cetera. So it's all these different touch points. It really, I think, touches on the last question really well. So it's just these different touch points that a brand might have.
Great. Looks like we have one more question here. How is success measured by a marketer? From things ranging from clicks, is there any type of attribution model? And you may have driven the initial engagement, but not necessarily via click-through. So how are marketers measuring the effectiveness of using social data for their digital campaigns?
Yeah, let me jump on that one. I think that's a really good question, and I think it's frankly, there is no simple answer. Attribution modeling is there's a lot of efforts going on in that across the board to understand, really what is driving better results. And so, I think the answer has to be, well, it depends upon what your business requirements and business goals are. And so if you're trying to drive sales as one example or profit or margin or others, measuring the effectiveness of those campaigns on which leveraging social data is really the best answer. And so looking at how those things are driving better results, and then looking at how, from the opens to the clicks to the eventual conversions, how all of those things are changing and impacted by using better targeting and better personalization as the social data might provide you. So, at the end of the day, you have to understand your own business, your own goals, and really that is going to establish what the right metrics to measure are. And then using tools like a StrongView have to both, report against it, so look retroactively what occurred, as well as establish better tests and optimizations to understand how do I construct more, sophisticated tests, if you will, to really test theories about what might work better. And so it's a combination of those things which are going to drive those results and give you deeper understanding to what's actually driving your business goals at the end of the day.
Well, Sean, Patrick, thank you so much for all the information today. It looks like that's all the questions that we have. We'd like to let everyone know that there will be a recording of the webinar along with the deck made available to all registrants, as well as a complimentary guide on the subjects we discussed today, co-authored by both Gigya and StrongView. Please make sure to add info@strongview.com to your safe senders list to receive that communication. And we thank you again for attending and look forward to seeing you at our next webinar. Have a great day.